Oh, why not? Bloody hell, they,
Anything happening?
They they worked, don't they? Well, you're not getting anything.
No, I've got nothing.
I'm in trouble. I'm going to have to sit down soon. Aren't they incredible?
Well, if you want to make a dash.
Well, we'll make a dash soon. I'll struggle on for a little while.
Would you like something to lean on?
Oh, no, something else I was going... Well, just I'll just go this. Something else I was worried about was the Olympic torch.
Mm.
Nobody knows where to...
Where
it should go.
Bloody hell, see what you mean. Bloody hell, you do need to lean, don't you?
I don't know how long the effect lasts. I've heard upwards of an hour and a half.
I think so.
An hour and a half?
An hour and a half. Sort of Errol Flynn. Bloody proportions. the Olympic torch.
Mm.
I think every kiddie should be able to see and fiddle and take home the Olympic torch as it comes through Australia.
Gee, it is embarrassing, this, Roy. I'm sorry to interrupt, but...
Are you in trouble?
Well, listen, maybe we should bloody get on with it and sit down.
Yeah, OK. And now, we'll come back to that Olympic issue in a minute.
Yeah.
And now, customers, can you welcome to the Channel 9 show a woman who, this week, listed on a rival channel the top 10 most tooly people on the planet. Niners, can you do it loudly and do it lewdly as you welcome supermodel Sarah O'Hare?
Watch, look at her there, perched at the top of a catwalk stair. Watch, look at her move, able to balance and stay in the groove. Look at her walk, ready to siphon and watch her talk. Let's all stare, listen and stare at Sarah O'Hare.
Oh. Sarah, thank you. Yes, very glamorous indeed. Very, very glamorous. Now, you're the representative on the planet of the 100% Wonder Bra.
That's it.
The Wonder Bra, how good is it?
It works.
Yes. Look, I put it to you that it's nowhere near as good as anything that Hickory's done, anything that Burley's done over the last 40 or 50 years. In fact, I put it to you that it's nowhere near as good as L Intimates.
Oh, careful there. But then you might say also it's not as good as Viagra.
No, but I'm wearing the Hickory Wonder Bra.
Are we testing it? Because I was going to say that Viagra's not working.
Oh, well, it was a delayed start for me, so maybe it'll be a delayed start with the Wonder Bra as well. Listen, speaking of the Wonder Bra, we've got some pictures of the launch.
Oh, yes.
At the relatively recent launch here. And let's have a look at those now. They do make interesting viewing. Here it is. The gun goes off. You start to appear.
That's a launch.
That is a launch. And then, of course, the snappers are snapping away there. And then this fog sets in. It's a sort of an outdoor launch. And then the fog photographers go away disappointed. The night did improve mercifully after that. And you did get the message across about that it's, in your estimation, just behind Burley, Hickory and L Intimate in its
ability. No, I think it's definitely ahead of all of those, I have to say.
Now, you're in making up, your hand never touches... Well, I assume in your life, your hand never touches your face.
No.
And yet I see other people touching your face.
Yeah, I'm lucky, actually, I get to have a makeup artist do my makeup. So.
Is this a family secret?
This is not how I wake up in the morning.
No. Is this a family secret or a O'Hare remedy?
Secret herbs and spices?
Yeah, sort of style.
That sort of thing, yeah.
And why do you do it? Why do you have this discipline?
To have the hair and makeup done.
No. So your hands don't touch your face.
So I don't touch my own face.
Yes.
No, I don't. I think that if I did touch my own face, I'd probably have a scary result. I have no idea how to do makeup.
Right.
So you don't mean literally you never touch your face. You
know,
like if you've got a gumpy or something like that.
Not a little green man.
No, a pimple or something like that.
Okay.
What do you do to squeeze it? Do you do you get someone else to do it for you? Or?
No, I don't get pimples.
Of course you bloody
do. No, of course I don't.
I saw you out there earlier before the makeup people got to you. You were covered in bloody gumpies. From start to finish.
Spackfill.
Yeah, there you touched your face. You did, you bloody did.
That's it.
Now, you played the Royal Pines golf course, I
think.
I did, yes. With Carrie Webb, and I think you won.
And we won.
Yeah. Now, I noticed you played barefooted. Now, well, I mean, I've been up there. The rules are pretty clear on what you've got to wear on your feet as well as everywhere else. How did you...
I know, but, I, it's funny because I've worn stilettos day in and day out, and those golf shoes are the most painful thing I've ever worn.
Is that right?
Yes. I don't know the rules of golf either. I've never played golf before that.
Right.
And
it must have been pretty stiff beautiful. Bloody competition that day, then. Who were you playing against? Ian Baker Finch. Who else?
Yes.
We played Ambrose, which, you know, that means that you get to follow the pro's ball, so I didn't actually see where mine went. Actually, most of the time it was still on the tee.
Right.
It wasn't very impressive at all. But, yeah, you know the Royal Pines, though, it's gorgeous, and all the grass is so manicured, and I was like, oh, you know, after New York, it's like, you know, I never see my feet for months, so... I thought I might live in luck.
Well, I think it was just mangrove rubbish before they did it up.
Must have been up there.
Yeah, the Royal Pines. Yeah, yeah. Now, this supermodel business that you're now in, what's the difference between a supermodel and just a model?
I don't know. To be serious, it's sort of a strange term, and I think it's more kind of like an 80s term that was really about the sort of glossy image model. And I think now what you're seeing, probably what we think of as supermodels, is going from just being a girl who's modelling and having her picture taken is going to a girl that's representing products and being a spokesperson and being up there and much more of a personality behind the model.
Now,
I'll accept that.
During the week, you fronted a program, I think it might have been for the Cosmopolitan magazine, concerning the 10 most, you know, obviously desirable people on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
The top number one was a cop-out, I think, in making the Australian swimming team the most desirable thing on the planet. I just think that was sort of easy, so you didn't have to pin it on one person. Number two was Leonardo DiCaprio. I put it to you that Leonardo's never had a half husky in his life. He would have to take Viagra tablets from now until tomorrow morning, and then he would probably just want a long lie down.
Yeah.
He doesn't strike me as somebody who really anybody would really want to accept as, well, a relative, really, let alone...
No, I agree. I think if anyone, it should have been you.
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, I find that disappointing.
Look, should
have
been number one.
No, I was thinking about 15, actually. Oh. I thought Roy could get in the top 10.
Yeah. Well, nobody asked me about it. Turns out. Does it worry you that, you know, a lot of kiddies who, you know, might be interested in looking like you, but it's a biological impossibility? Does that concern you at all? You know, obviously you wear the Wonder Bra and what have you,
so people
can wear it and look like you. Well, obviously it's often not the case.
I know, and people always say to me, you know, okay, they want to hear about my diet or they want to hear about my beauty regime and things like that. And I just have to say that I am really, really lucky that I'm tall enough to be able to be a model.
Yeah.
That worked against me when I wanted to do ballet, when I wanted to be a dancer, you know.
Yeah,
I couldn't.
Too tall.
And so I had to quit.
But
so
you could have played AFL.
I don't know, with these skinny legs, I don't know.
Yeah, I know.
But, so I think that, you know, we can sort of advertise for people how to groom themselves and look better, but,
But it doesn't worry you that in a way, you're sort of selling an illusion.
I think that anything, like, in the entertainment industry, like film, I mean, when you see a beautiful film and someone makes you feel romantic or someone makes you feel happy, it's that sort of fantasy, it's that sort of image where, you know, you look at a girl running along a beach and you're like, you know, that just looks like the most peaceful moment or something. And it's just sort of a way to make you feel, I think, rather than I want to look like that and if I can't, that's it, you know.
Right. So people, if they're going to buy a Wonder Bra, then, they're not expecting at all to look like you. Then
not
why
like
are they paying you a lot of money to sell
Wonder
it?
But Wonder Bras do work, though. That's
what's
the best
what's the theory? I mean, it reminds me of the lovable cross your heart bra. Is it the same philosophy?
No, I don't know about the cross your heart. I'm not sure about...
I think it's sort of had a tag. She's wonderful, she's active. Oh, boy, is she attractive because she's lovable in her lovable bra. Lovable, that was
it.
Okay. Lovable cross your heart.
Right.
Is the Wonder Bra the same sort of philosophy?
It sort of lifts and separates. I think push together.
Oh, right, push together.
Yeah, cleavage. No, I think with Wonder Bra... I think it's really just about being glamorous. Like, when you're putting on an evening dress and you want to be sort of feeling glamorous, then, you know, you put on a Wonder Bra and you have that extra bit of help. And,
right.
Yeah, I think it's just sort of anything that we do, like colouring our hair and being made up and yeah. putting on a beautiful dress, it's just yeah. part of that.
Just part of that.
Yeah. Now, you're here for Australian Fashion Week.
Yes.
How does Australian fashion compare, you know, in your international stakes? I mean, I was talking to Vivienne Westwood last night, the English designer.
Oh, yes, yeah.
She's very, very disappointed with what's on display this year. How are you seeing it?
I'm actually amazed. I think Australian fashion is incredible. And I really, after being, I went to my fittings today, this morning, for the shows, and I really noticed that because Australia is so multicultural and environmentally diverse and our culture is diverse, and it really comes across in the fashion. You know, you're seeing Akira Isagawa, who has a complete Japanese influence, Il Alijan, who's sort of got a Turkish
yeah.
influence.
Yeah.
Zimmerman, who's from Bondi.
Zimmerman.
So, you know, I think...
And Roy, the House of Roy from Lithgow.
Yeah. Oh, the House of Roy, yeah.
Do you ever come across gear, though, you think, oh, I'm not going to wear this?
Yes.
This is just quite ordinary. I wouldn't be seen dead in this, right?
You know, that Peter Morrissey, isn't he a
poser? That's rubbish. Rubbish.
You know, can barely slip into a pair of jeans.
You might as well dive into a toilet.
Come and see Peter Morrissey's collection, you will die.
It's rubbish. Have you ever come across... Have you ever come across stuff that you have thought, no?
Definitely. Everyone has different tastes.
Yeah. Yes. And do you put your foot down and say, I'm not wearing this? Not
never doing that job again. Donna Karen's on the bad books.
Yeah. No, I think you have to understand, you kind of have to take fashion as a bit of an art. And this person is creating what they see as an art, and you go along with it.
Now,
and actually, sometimes it's amazing stuff that you put on, beautiful stuff.
Yeah. When you arrive at the job, is there a lot of direction from, you know, the helpers of the design house on how you're meant to look in these things? So sometimes you know can go for full-on ponce, sometimes you can go for total haute, or is that left up to you? I'm always amazed by this, because what seems to happen is that in a parade, the models tend to all look as though they're cut from roughly the same hunk of wood.
Yeah.
You know, not meaning that they wouldn't, but they all come out appearing.
Fashion-wise, or how they...
No, same attitude. Same attitude. Up yours, or I hate your guts, or peaceful, or something like that.
Yeah.
Do you get that sort of direction? Peter Morrissey might say, look, this has got to be really, like...
In your face.
You.
No, definitely.
Attitude. Street cred.
No, I think definitely with the definitely the designer's got a whole image that they want.
Yeah.
You know, this is their show. This is their little piece of their image.
Yeah.
And they definitely tell you how they want you to look.
And when you're doing it, I used to imagine I was someone like I might think, oh, this Mark Woodford, this is worth for. So I might try to be Mark Woodford when I do it. Do you think of
so
people when
into
you're
character kind of?
Yeah.
Right.
Do you do that?
No.
No. Could you show us the skill?
No, I'm usually thinking about something else.
Yeah, show us the skill. Now, let's imagine you've got to come down here, let's say the last two steps, and go across this way, then prop, come back over to this point. I mean, is that possible?
Yeah.
Yeah, do you want to take the steps? Okay.
Okay.
Right.
But then I've got to show you how the guys do it, will you do it with me?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, sure.
So I'll just show you first that the guys go like this, right? Crinkled forehead. Right? And that's cool, it's good. Maybe I might have to lose this though, I don't know.
Oh no, I've got to keep the gear on.
Alright. I just sort of cruise to the end and then that's it, look at that. Tell you something about this industry. This is the fun part, definitely the fun part.
Yeah.
But this industry is a business.
Ah.
And it's good. And it's really good. It's an incredible business.
You mean it's the getting to the stairs to make the walk. That's the trick.
No.
That's where it's vicious dog eat dog, knife in
exactly
your back.
That's exactly what you had to do tonight, wasn't it? Sort of walk from that makeup room to here.
That's the hard bit.
Yeah, that was the hard bit.
Yeah. Oh, all right. Bloody hell, it's a nightmare.
Have you had a horror shoot? I think this is a question we ask all people in your position.
Yeah.
You know, you're reading your trades and your popular weekly magazines, in your fashion mags, about the horror shoot in Mauritius, or the horror shoot that went horribly wrong in the Seychelles when the tide came up before they could get the shots. What in your opinion, is a horror shoot, and have you had many?
No, I'd have to say that I've never had a bad experience with anything. Yeah. It's really been incredible.
Yeah.
Really, it's so much fun. It's so great. It's an incredible job.
And this job is taking you on to the Letterman show. I'm just wondering, now that you've been with us for, well, the best part of 10 minutes, could you make some comparisons between Dave's handiwork and our handiwork?
Okay, well, let me think.
Apart from that, anything else?
Yeah.
Now, you've been off the cable show, haven't you? Who would you like to talk to?
Well, that's the thing. Dave Letterman, I think.
You'd get Dave on. Anyone else?
And then maybe I'll swap positions with you.
Yes.
And give you a hard time.
Okay.
And would yours be the show that you're working on, would it be a fashion-based program or more variety program?
It's definitely more of a celebrity sort of chat show kind of thing. But you see, I'm sort of working on my career like I did with modelling, going into TV and going into film, really building my image and which way I want to go. So I'm not even sure if that's exactly what I want to do, if I want to go into film or... So I'm just sort of in the process.
Paralysed by choice.
All out at the moment.
Yeah.
Well, we wish you luck with all of that, Sarah. And as you know, we do have commitments here which prevent us from locking horns all night, as it so often does in the fashion caper. Australia, can you drop them loudly as a way of thanking Sarah O'Hare?
Since way back when, and this year it's gonna be a winner again. But I want you to know, after all these years,
we're still having fun.
Hungry. Add a dab and have a stab.
Charles Woolley, an embarrassment? Charles, let's talk about you. Friends of yours say that you are an embarrassment. Colleagues, work colleagues, say that you are embarrassing. David Leckie at Channel 9 says that you are often an embarrassment to the network.
Embarrassment is a word that you use very often.
I'm Liz Hayes.
I'm Charles Woolley.
I'm H.G. Nelson.
And I'm Roy Slade. All these stories and more tomorrow on 60 Minutes.
Yes, the arts in Australia are going through a golden period. Never have more people wanted to go and spend a night at the ballet. And August 1914 is a ballet at the top of my must-see list. Roy, you've had a shifty at this historical work. What events from August of 1914 does it portray in dance?
Yeah, it's a beautiful work, HG. It's a lot of soldiers.
Yes.
Men dressed as soldiers, that is.
With the medals?
With the medals and weaponry.
Fixed bayonets.
Fixed bayonets. Mm. And they sort of dance out point work. And it's very hard to do point work on duckboards.
Yes.
Very hard. They tiptoe out, tippy-toe out, tippy-toe out, and then you get a simulated bang! They fall down.
Right.
And then people come on and, you know, carry them off. And then another lot come on. Tippy-toe out. Bang! Down they go. Then they get
taken
off.
The first lot have snuck around the back.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. And then they come out again.
Yeah.
And this goes on for about 4 hours.
Yes.
It's a very moving, grueling. It's a grueling, confronting work. But very, very telling. I didn't realise so many people died in the First World War. I didn't realise it was all about, you know, shooting and killing.
Have they got slouch hats?
Yes.
And all that sort of gear?
Yeah, absolutely authentic.
You've obviously spent some time serving this country in foreign theatres of war. How does it actually capture in this parade of flesh and the bangs and the tippy dippy 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 dippy, the actual reality of war?
No. You very rarely in trench warfare would you dance over the top. You might put your head up. Come on, mate. Over the top that way.
Yeah.
But rarely would you stand up proudly, hands up, with your gun up like this. Oh, yeah. You wouldn't do it.
No.
I don't think you would.
No. No.
And certainly I went with a couple of diggers, and they said it was nothing like that at all.
Right.
They imagined it more like I did.
Yeah, that's what it
is. Because you don't want to get shot.
No. Now, look, the other thing that does worry me about it is that I do have a little bit of a barrier with the ballet, as I largely see it as a form of expression where men in particular are poncing around in mauve-coloured tights with the cruets, you know, tucked up in a big bulging...
Codpiece.
And I find that hard to mesh with the car keys, the big boots and the hat.
Yeah.
And I also worry about the musical choice. I mean, you know, the First World War hits were things like Pack Up Your Troubles in the Old Kip Bag, It's a Long Way... that's right, you're coming again. Yeah, it's
carried
a
off.
Long way to Tipperary.
Yeah,
that's right. A long way to Tipperary.
Bang!
Off they go again. Is it that sort of school?
That's how it is.
Mm.
And I suspect the tights and the codpiece are under the
Khaki. Right. Now, Roy, the other thing is that this will be performing at the Sydney Opera House, and there has been some chat recently about doing away with the original design of those marvellous front steps coming down like that, which many people in the audience would be familiar with. Many visitors to Sydney consider it a landmark, the Opera House steps. I think the last Crowded House concert was incidentally performed there, and I know I've been there many, many times to see bands like the Angels and so on. Yeah. Doing away with all of that and creating a new entrance there. What's the actual plan here, and have you had a look at some of the designs, and what do you think?
I don't like the designs all that much, but then I don't like the Opera House.
Don't you?
No, I'd start again.
Would you?
It was designed by Jørn Utzon.
Yeah, that bloke.
That bloke, he's Danish or something.
Yes.
Well, it'd be fine if it was in Denmark.
Yeah.
But it's not built for Australian conditions.
No.
You know, it's all steps. I suppose the philosophy is that life is hard or life is mountainous. I don't know if there are a lot of mountains there or not.
Yeah.
I suspect there are.
Yeah.
Well, if that's the case, it's perfect for there, because there's bloody steps everywhere.
Yeah.
Everywhere. It should be flat for Australia.
Yeah.
There are mountains. Oh, sure, you're just snowy.
Yeah.
But that's about it when it comes to mountains. Your Great Dividing Range, but I wouldn't call that particularly mountainous.
Big? No.
No, or big.
Look.
I smashed the money. There were no toilets there.
Yeah.
There's only one or two toilets.
All right.
Anyway, you got a queue of a couple of hundred people bloody queuing up there. You go in there, you wouldn't bloody... I mean, you couldn't stay in there.
Look,
because people forget where to go and all that, because they're in a hurry.
Lost.
They get lost.
Dying.
You go into the main concert theatre, you can't hear anything.
No.
So the acoustics are terrible. It looks stupid, it's all curved and... Oh, no, knock the bloody lot down and mill us a nice big Australian fibro box.
Right.
Yeah?
I'm right with you, Roy.
And then we could put on ballets.
Yeah.
Ballets that meant things like, I don't know, the Billy and the Snowy River Scheme.
Yeah, in tights.
In tights, there's
a ballet. And songs.
Well, the Bathurst 500.
Right.
Actually, it'll be a sitting sort of ballet. Yeah.
But noise, a lot of noise.
Act one might be Jack Knight, Jack Murray. He'd be a bit more up like that.
Yeah.
An old bloke.
Mm.
And then Brocky.
Mm.
There's a ballet.
Yeah, that's true. Look, can
with
I...
sound effects.
Look, can I ask you to set out
two Woodies.
Ah!
Here's a ballet!
The failure of Mildura.
Yes!
That's right, the Davis Cup debacle against the Black family.
Yeah, with a racket, one left-handed. Yeah, tippy-tippy-tippy. Yeah. Bang!
Now, Roy, look, two ideas I want to put to you. For people who know the area, there's a fabulous car park there at the Opera House.
It's the only thing going for it.
I know, but wouldn't it be good if somehow you could get out of your car and walk into the Opera House without going outside at all.
I'd rather watch the opera from the car.
Now, that's exactly my point.
why don't we have access straight into the main concert hall, up those steps on a ramp, so you can park the cars and watch the path. And
when he hits the window there.
Yeah, put the speaker in, like at the drive-in, and when he hits a bum note, and flash the headlights.
Yeah.
Wow, that's the Australian way, Roy.
That would be an Australian opera house.
That's right. And then I bet you more people would go.
Of course they would.
You wouldn't have any trouble.
No. I wouldn't have got a watch to put on.
And you'd be
people in there in the car, buddy, enjoying it.
That's right. And kids would be sneaking in with it in the boot. And you'd have hundreds of people get into it.
Or kids lying down in the back seat with a blanket over them. Once you get in, we're okay. A couple of little heads coming up here, seeing things.
Yes, that's right.
Seeing the culture.
Being there,
part. You don't want to go, buddy. 100 miles away from where you're gonna go.
Then walk up the steps.
Then walk up bloody steps, what's in style? Yeah. I've had it with that bloody place, it's a joke. Yeah. Bomb it! Yeah. Knock the bloody thing, I'd rather it was just metal and point.
Mate, wouldn't we all?
Just over the outdoors.
Yes, yes. Gee, it's given me something to think about, though, that idea. That you'll be able to watch
Joan Sutherland, if she came back. She'd come back and watch over there.
She'd come back.
Of course she'd come back. And have cars in there with people in them honking when she hit a bum note. She'd love it. And it'd just be all honks these days. She hasn't hit a bloody correct note since 1956.
Yes.
And she wouldn't mind me saying that.
And the ballet.
Well, I did hear it. Well, she got a one note right once. Well, I wasn't there. I read about it.
Yeah. I think that was when somebody stepped on a toe, though. It wasn't actually during a performance.
Yeah. Right.
Well, I'm glad that we've sorted that out.
Yeah. Well, it's simple. You've just got to go to the simplest solution every time.
Yeah. Start again.
Start again?
Yeah. Right. We were going to spend some time talking about Alan Bond's artwork at this point. Roy, maybe you could just quickly take us through Alan's.
Oh, it's very good.
Yes.
It's very good. People... Honestly, his irises
are as good as
Van Gogh's. Yeah.
Oh,
the only difference between his wit. That's the only difference.
Yes.
And Peter Brock's doing a bit of art too, and I think he's working in Duco. He does a lovely, there's a lovely piece of his I saw called 4,000 Ribs.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just a sort of donk in Duco. Beautiful.
Beautiful. Beautiful. And how does Alan handle the life drawing when the jailer wheels in the nude?
Oh, no, I think he's okay with that.
Is he good?
Yeah, he's good with foreshortening. Yes. If it's a guard on Viagra, I think he's got trouble.
Yes. Now, my very good friends, the Channel 9 show tonight is presenting a couple of Mother's Day melodies as part of the big Mother's Day blow-off here this evening on the Channel 9 show.
Yes.
Can you give a chocolates and breakfast in bed welcome to our very own Current Affairs with the old Pretender's Chestnut, a Mother's Day plea if ever I heard one. Don't get me wrong! Take it away, Affairs!
Satan's Dutch Church of Sin, Gifton's Wagon.
Innovations.
Hi, and welcome to Innovations. And I'm proud to say our guest again in the studio today is Professor Skeet Waterman from the Johns Hopkins University in New York. Professor, great to see you again.
Thank you, Ian. Likewise, I'm sure.
Now, I'm sure you're going to blow my mind today.
I think I might, Ian.
All right. Well, first of all, what is this object and what does it do?
Two very good questions, Ian. Let me start by answering the first. This is the Lombard double-action colon stimulator.
Wow, that sounds fantastic.
And to answer your second question, what does it do? It stimulates the colon in a way that keeps it supple, relaxed, and most importantly, clean.
So a clean colon is important?
Oh, excellent observation, Ian. Yes, it is. As we get older, our bodies become less interested in cleaning the colon, and we have to give our bodies a little help.
So are there any side effects?
Ian, you amaze me. Well, yes, there is. Go figure this. With a stimulated colon, one is inclined to think a little more about sex.
Great. Well, that's great. So, would a product like Alhulio's bum grease be of any assistance whatsoever?
Yes, indeed it would. You see, a lubricated passage is always going to be far more pleasant.
Right. Well, I think I might get one myself. And at the price we're showing on the screen, anyone can afford one.
Oh, that's very nice of you to say so.
Okay, the Lombard Colon Stimulator is available by calling the number on the screen right now. And don't forget, it's backed by our famous 30-day trial and test guarantee. If you're not completely satisfied, your money back. Well, Professor, I don't know how you do it.
Neither do I.
And I'll be back again next week with more innovations.
Thanks
very
much.
You just need to lift and separate him.
Good. Yes, yes, you've got the Wonder ball bag.
Underpants. Wonder underpants. They're excellent.
Yes.
I don't think they've reached here yet, but no. I think they're on their way down.
Right. Now, look, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, you know, were you surprised at its success initially?
Well, I wasn't insane, so yes.
Yes, yes. So you could actually count the numbers that was being sold. And the other thing is that now you've written 5 volumes of a trilogy.
Well, maths was never my good point.
Yes, yes, no. And what is there any more parts, do you think, of the trilogy?
There probably will be another one day at some point in the future, but I'm not saying anything more than that because, I mean, people have sort of said to me, you know, because in the last book I killed off all the characters, and they say, are they really dead? And I say, well, you know, this is fiction. Mm. It's science fiction, and it's comedy science fiction. What do you mean by really, you know?
Yeah. Well, we were thinking of, before, we were just tossing around the idea of a prequel to right before the removal of the Earth.
Yes, well, actually, I have to say that destroying the Earth
was a bit
in
of a
the
problem.
First chapter was rash. You know, it always occurred to me. I mean, one of the thinking behind it was, you see so many sort of, you know, hokey movies or whatever, where the big thing is, are we going to save the Earth from destruction? And of course, they always do. So I thought, well, let's just get it out of the way to begin with. And then once you've done that, you could see why they actually always save it, because it's an enormous nuisance not having it thereafter.
Yes.
But I mean, it wasn't even going to be science fiction. I mean, but then once you got rid of the Earth, I mean, you're either going to.
Wow,
you know,
it's very
you have a lot of light music, you know.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
Was it disappointing when it got to television? Did it disappoint you the way it was?
Yeah, you know, it's funny because people say. People say that, you know, television kind of destroys the pictures and isn't just. And it's right, it's true.
Yeah. But
not here, of course.
No, of course.
No, I mean,
is it because was it a budget problem?
Yes, well, the BBC, unfortunately, kind of has a habit of the way they make science fiction, which has started with Doctor Who and hasn't really sort of moved on.
Yes.
So they yes. regard it as a point of honour that the sets have to sort of wobble and all that kind of stuff. And
But you've sold it recently to Disney, I think, or some section of it. I mean,
that's right, yeah, Disney. Well, I always have to say when people, because people say, Disney, you know, Hitchhiker, and I say, well, yes, but of course, Disney not only made Bambi, they also made Pulp Fiction.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And the Hitchhiker movie will be somewhere on a kind of line between those two. I'm not going to say which is going to be closer.
And will it be the original one that was made for television that's now made into film, or some...
Well, it's funny. I mean, over the years, I've been rewriting it over and over again, and it's moved all around the place, and I'm actually going to bring it back home, actually, and make it very like the original now for this. So,
do the Americans have any conditions? Like, do they have trouble, sensibility-wise, getting it? I mean...
I mean, this is a story I'd be loath to tell on American television because I wouldn't want to offend people very much. Yeah. But I'll tell it here. When I first sold the rights to Ivan Reitman, this is back in 1983, and it turned out actually after a while he hadn't actually read the book. I mean, he'd merely read the sales figures, and I mean, the book is 156 pages long, and these are busy guys in Hollywood.
And there are a lot of words on each page.
That's right. Yes. Okay. And so I wrote a first draft of the screenplay. And I showed it to him, and he sort of read it for a while and sort of then called me to his office and said, well, I've read it, and there's quite a lot of things here I like, but some other things I think we really need to talk about. He said, like, for instance, you say we're going to find this thing you call the answer to the ultimate question of life, the universe, and everything, and that's great. He said, that's terrific. A lot of people want to know that kind of stuff, particularly here in California. but then what do? You know, you build it up a bit. We don't find out quite yet, and that's good. That's okay. You know, build up a bit of tension. Then what do? You just say, well, it's 42. Mm-hmm. Well, I think the audience is going to feel really jerked off by that. And that was the moment I knew the game was up.
So come back when you got a better answer.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, you remember you were saying that there's a separation of education at an early age, which is unfortunate. The arts and sciences are separate. You've got to choose a path.
Yes, we are lifted and separated at a very early age. And this is particularly in England. You know, from the age of about sort of 15 or whatever, you're told you're either going to be an artist or you're going to be a scientist. And you make up your mind now. And thereafter, you are taught to despise each other.
Yeah.
And so what happens in England is, but particularly, you know, by the time you sort of get beyond sort of university and so on, we really despise each other at university. I mean, as far as the art students are concerned, you know, the sort of science students are sort of wandering around. Every now and then they sort of poke their heads out of their holes and try to grow beards and things. The scientists regard the art students as a lot of lazy layabouts. And I have to say, having been an art student, they are right. But then you see, once you get under the outside world, you know, all of your opinion formers, your writers, your broadcasters, your journalists, all come from the outside. So if you're a scientist, you're really expected to come in the tradesman's entrance, and people really don't know what you're up to and don't want to know what you're up to. And it's a bad thing.
Yeah. But there's an obvious interest you have in science. Obviously.
Yes. Well,
one of your heroes, I think you said, is Richard Feynman.
That's right.
Yes. He was a cosmologist.
And a great drum player.
And a drummer as well. Well, I don't know if he was good or not, but he certainly had a shot at it.
Well, it's funny.
I think he had a speed-up problem, which is...
He had a what?
A speeding-up problem.
Yes. Well, oddly enough, I mean, I've discovered that's actually one of the trickiest things about playing. Now, I mean, this sounds like a sort of strange segue into sort of blowing my... Well, I was going to say
no, into music,
my,
because into you do music. Enjoy music. You've played with Pink Floyd.
I did play with Pink Floyd. The very, very, very easy bit that every sort of 12-year-old guitarist can play in Brain Damage and Eclipse. And this is on stage. Actually, going out in front of that many people, you can see why these guys do it.
Yes. Did you get sweaty palms?
I had a very, very easy bit to play, but the difficult bit, and Richard Feynman would have found this too, I mean, he's okay at sort of quantum chromodynamics and so on, but playing slowly is very, very, very hard. Yeah. And, I mean, the great strength of Pink Floyd was they played glacially slowly, and that's the whole effect. It's just brilliant.
Yeah. Did you speed up? Did you come in early?
Yes. And the bass player, Guy Pratt, was sort of standing there, sort of going like that to me.
Because you were listening. You were just focusing on what you were doing.
Yeah, exactly, yes. And feeling slightly nervous. And the odd thing is, having been out the front, huge, huge walls of sound and light. Yeah. Up on stage, it's really quite quiet. You can sit and have a cup of tea, you know. I mean, there's not much going on. I mean, all the sound goes that way.
Right.
Now, you're here with a video game. Starship Titanic. We've got a little clip of this lifted off the game. Let's have a look at it now. Here you are, introducing it.
My name is Fintable. I am the Doorbot serving on this maiden voyage.
Well, these are tremendous special effects, aren't they? Very convincing. Very convincing.
The idea of the game, as nearly as I can tell, is to explore the ship.
Yes,
the
what happened?
It's
what
not
happened?
A shooting 'em up score game. It's a
no, it's definitely
a
not. We decided to go for the non-psychopath sector of the market.
Do you get to kill anyone? No.
Well, in fact, I mean, a number of, because we deliberately said you will not get to kill anybody in this, but you know, and go for the non-psychopath part of the market. But I have had one or two people come up to me and say, Douglas, you know, I'm a psychopath, and psychopaths are people too. Yeah. So what have you got for me in this game? To which I say, well, actually, you do get to do something fiendishly horrible to a flock of starlings.
Well, can you torture them with drills and stuff like that? Can you really give them some hammer?
You have to puree a flock of starlings. It's very sad. Right. It's very
sad. And how do you win? By getting the ship going or bringing it back?
You win
or?
By just having as much fun as you possibly can, really. Right. I mean, there's nothing actually sort of keeping a score there.
And you can wear glasses and have it in 3D.
There's one little bit right at the end that you can wear glasses for if you really want to look very silly. I mean, the great thing about this game, and the thing that made me want to do it, was having seen beautiful graphics games where you wander around, but it's kind of like a stage set where you're waiting for a play to happen, but it doesn't happen. I thought, we want to be able to converse with the characters, so I sat down and with two other co-writers, because it was a huge, huge job, created 10,000 lines of dialogue, and there's this incredibly sophisticated conversation engine at the heart of the game. Which means that you can sort of sit down and you can talk to all of these characters. And we've got the actors in to play them. Actually, one of the actors we've got, a great old friend of mine, Terry Jones of Monty Python. And we got him to play the part of the semi-deranged parrot, which is, of course, as everybody will realize, is the part he was born to play. And he does it fantastically. I mean, he did explain to me that every other part he'd ever had up till then, he played as a parrot. And this is, I mean, you remember, Mandy, Mother of Brian. He's not the Messiah! I mean, it's clearly a parrot. Yeah. So this is the fact, we actually, on this game, we've outed him as a parrot. And he was in seventh heaven.
Well, look, it might take me several hours to get there.
Absolutely, yes. I mean, as I say, it's something like 16 hours of dialogue if you just sort of play it, bam, straight through.
So the game might take a week to...
Yeah.
Though there have 24 been... hours a day, it might take... Yeah.
Oh, well. Provided you stop and talk to the characters. I mean, some people have just been sort of whisking through it, which is rather like sort of getting a helicopter to the top of Everest and saying you've done it.
Now, you've got an enormous collection of left-handed guitars, I understand. Yes. Now, obviously you play the guitar and you are left-handed, but how did the idea come to collect them? What have you got? Who's
the big
one? And what would you like to get? Just take us through
it. Oh, well, I mean, the reason, you see, growing up, a left-handed guitar player, you're really very disadvantaged because you can never find a left-handed guitar anywhere. And so, you know, you just get a, you know, get one string at the other way around. But everybody else's guitar, you know, you can't play. So I only had an acoustic guitar, I mean, a dreadful old acoustic guitar. So I learned to play acoustic guitar. And I learned by listening to old Paul Simon records and that kind of thing. And so it was really sort of quite late in life. I suddenly thought, hang on, if I want to play some other guitars, I can buy some.
Yes.
And you know what happens when you get that kind of bug.
Yes.
It turned out there are two stores in the world that specialize in left-handed guitars, and one's in Hollywood, and the other is in Leytonstone in East London. And for a brief time, I was kind of best customer at each. And, you know, it gets terrifying when you realize how many shops you are best customer at.
Yes.
So how many have you got, just roughly? 200,
3? About a couple of dozen. It was up to about 30 at one point. But you see, I was once in a store somewhere, and I came across somebody else who was, I mean, it was a regular guitar store and only had one left-handed guitar. Oh. And there were only two customers in the shop, and we were both looking at it, which is rather sad, because we were both left-handed. Yes. And we had confided to each other, we both had the same problem, that we did collect them. And it was a question of how do you get them past your wife? You know, because she says, I don't think I've seen that one before. Yeah. She carries. She says, oh, no, it's just been off for a pair.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm just bringing it back. No, you hadn't noticed that. That was, you know.
You can't explain it. This one's got a fabulous ace.
Now, have you got anything that Hendrix might have touched? Have you got
no,
scrap?
No, I'm afraid.
I know
not,
he
nothing.
Didn't play. He played left-handedly, but he's
well,
turned
I mean,
the bugger upside
extraordinary.
Down.
I mean, there are all sorts of different kinds of left-handedness. I mean, like Paul McCartney, who is, I guess, a sort of most famous left-handed guitar player. I mean, he started out trying to play right-handed and just thought, well, I can't play the guitar until somebody said, try it that way around. Yeah. But then there's Mark Knopfler of Dire Straits who just learned to play right-handed. And some people can do
John
it.
John McEnroe, of course, great left-handed guitarist.
Who?
John McEnroe.
The tennis
player.
Oh,
yes, indeed. Yeah. Ah, yes. Yes, he's, well, he's certainly left-handed.
Yes.
Are there any, like, you know, sort of Les Pauls with a flame top with a...
Well, you know, there's one, I mean, there is a guitar, I mean, I talked about this on the radio once in England. I said, it was Desert Island Discs, and I was asked what luxury I would like, and I said I would like, and I didn't even know if one existed, but a pre-war Martin D-28, no, D-45, that's the one with all the sort of mother of pearl.
A very loud guitar.
And well, it depends. Ish.
Loud,
ish. Yeah. Well, big bodies.
Yes. Yeah.
And, where was I?
D-45.
Did you get it?
No, I mentioned on the right that this is the thing I would like. A factory-made, left-handed D-45 pre-war. And I did get a message from somebody saying, yes, one does exist, and you can have it for $250,000. So I was not going to try and sneak that one past my wife.
No, I understand. Look, Douglas, we could rabbit on all night about axes, but we do have commitments here at the Channel 9 show. Good luck with the Starship Titanic and future projects. Australia, can you give the galaxy a second chance as a way of thanking Douglas Adams?
This week in Plumage magazine, Laurie Oakes says yes to the skills of L.A.'s Fabio Giovanni, and the results are spectacular. Laurie as Mike Bailey. Laurie as Larry Emder. Laurie as David Kemp. Plumage, the ins and outs of who's up and what's up.
Hello, it's City. What am I doing? I'm on the steering committee for City Olympic Motors, directing you to a gold medal car deal. How do I win, you ask? You come to me, City. Twist my rings on. Watch the explosion. See? It's that simple to win a gold medal wheel deal at City Olympic Motors.
Your bar on the end of my line. Come on, bar boy. I'll bar my end if you bar yours. Call 00996229.
This old car's just about had the dick.
No problem. Our house has the perfect solution. Yes.
Embarrassing, isn't it?
Renovating your old mattress and a homemade swing, the perfect thing for the kids. Our house in Athens goes down now.
And now it's time for Come On In, Ray.
There's only one game to play at the business end of the day.
Once again, it's time to play Come On In, Ray, the game where you can win fabulous prizes simply by wondering which door Ray is behind. Is he behind door R, door A, or door Y? And remember, Come On In, Ray, each and every week, proudly presented by City Olympic Motors. Roy!
Yes, we have Grace joining us tonight. How are you?
Come on in, Grace.
Thanks. Nice, lovely to meet you.
Hello. Thanks very much.
And I believe, Grace, you're Mother of the Year.
Yes. With
congratulations.
Bernardo's.
Sorry, with?
Bernardo's.
With Bernardo's.
And
that's
Women's
fantastic.
Day.
And Women's Day. Well, congratulations.
Was there a competition? Was it, make 100 beds before 10 a.m. and then fry some fish, catch some fish, fry some fish, feed 20 starving kids? Is that the sort of comp you had to go through to become Mother of the Year?
Yeah.
And how much did you get ahead of the field? When did you know you had it in the bag? Was it after catching the fish? When you got to the fry, they were miles behind the other contestants?
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw a moment of hesitation.
No, that's fantastic. Oh, no, you blitzed them. Made every mother in Australia look ordinary.
Yeah, did
that's
I?
The impossible. No, well done. You're going to have to choose a door here that you think Ray might be behind. These are the knobs here. There's Y there, A there and R there to open the door and find Ray. Are you ready? Can we have the knock, please? Answer the door. Where's Ray?
Can I get three choices or one?
One choice.
Yes, one choice.
Open up a door. Well. Oh,
keep going.
Shot at the
Kenny Sutcliffe of chocolates.
The Kenny Sutcliffe of chocolates. Here we go.
First up, we get the apron out so you don't get any chocky or soups over yourself. There stick that on. This adds to your other prizes already run earlier today with the fish fry.
There we go. Now, you're going to have 9 seconds.
Nine whole seconds.
As many chocolates and soaps and things into there as you can. Are you ready?
Right.
Okay, 1, 2, 3.
Might have seen this show before somehow.
Well done, Grace.
I just get the feeling that may have seen what we've done before.
I don't think you should miss out on anything. Look
that's
at
what
that.
What I have to do to keep the lollies off the kids.
I can see why you want Mother of the Year.
Smuggle them into the house and don't let anybody else see them. Stick them under the bed where only you are able to get them. And of course, you have the Come On In Ray game. You can have all the fun of playing Come On In Ray at home.
And the fun home. There we go. We'll put that there. Guys, thank you very much. Congratulations, and thanks for playing. Come on in, Ray!
Yes, thanks for playing. Come on in, Ray. Come on in, Ray.
Yes, that sadly brings us to the end of the Channel 9 show for another week. But before we go, we've done something special tonight because of Mother's Day tomorrow. We've got the switchboard open. We've teed up some couriers. And have a look at what your mum could be waking up to tomorrow morning.
It's a marvellous photograph, HG, of Sandra Sully there moving across to Tim Webster. Look at the detail on that. That is a beautiful shot. Tens Talented Two. $49.95, unframed, of course, $499 framed. And we can have those delivered by tomorrow.
Yes, and there's just a couple of George Negus's left if any mum does feel as though they're...
There's a Mother's Day special, HG. We can have a look at the price. I think it was $2 for 8 unframed. Well, $2 frame. Let's say 20 of them for $2 framed. They really do look good.
They do, and I've cut mine into a jigsaw for Mum tomorrow.
How many pieces?
I've done it to 4,000 pieces, actually. Just over 4,000. I lost count at the 4,000 mark.
Because we haven't pointed out the dimension of these photographs. They are roughly 4 metres by 12.
Yeah. My smallest piece in my jigsaw is that big.
Yes, 4,000 pieces. Yes.
Now, what are you doing in the coming set of 7?
Well, I'm going to wallpaper Mum's room with George's. No. Just that'll cut George out and make it a sort of pastiche.
Yes. Mm. Well, look, On Monday night, I'm going to the Sydney Town Hall to hear Douglas Adams talk.
Yes.
He's a man full of tales, as you can see, and I think we'll be there for a few hours, at least 16, from my guesstimate. I'm not quite sure what time it kicks off, but your local papers will have the details.
Well, I might bring Mum down for that as well.
That's part of the Sydney Writers' Festival. And now the Channel 9 show completes its annual Mother's Day tribute. With a tune about a youngster who had a mum. And we've assembled a super group to present this for you. Tonight, the performance will be backed by Ian Terpsterpy and the Channel 9 All-Stars. Lay back and experience the golden throat of Mr. Dave Gleeson with a Credence smash. Fortunate Son! See you next week, miners!
With the current affairs, the Richard Carleton Experience. Special guests,
still the one.
Richard Carleton.
Still
Wendy Harbour, Richard Gayer and Tom Berlinson, and now our hosts of the show, Rampaging Roy Slaven and H.G. Nelson.
If you keep this up, we won't be able to start. And so stop. Thanks very much indeed, Ian Terpstappy. Thanks very much indeed, The Current Affairs. And thanks very much, too, to the Richard Carleton Experience. Hi there, consumers, and welcome to the Channel 9 show for another tip-top Saturday night. And it's an attractive leg of lamb media special that is roasting to perfection in the oven here at the 9 HQ this evening. But before we suck it and see and jump into bed and pull a newspaper over our head or fly the coop to walk on the wild side till dawn, Rampaging Roy Slaven, who or what's been sticking the bonce up out of the trout pate down your end of the spread this week, Squire?
Thank you very, very, very much, H.G. Nelson. Look, obviously it's been a difficult week. What with the budget, less said the better, with India having the bomb, tremendous news, the prospect of Pakistan having the bomb and Sri Lanka getting the bomb. Jakarta's bloody well virtually been bombed.
Yes.
Very hard to find what I'd call or what Axiom would describe as a little ray of sunshine.
Very true.
But we did when we went to the Clary Grimmett auction of Clary Grimmett memorabilia. I know you were there, I was there. I snared a very, very attractive pair of Clary Grimmett's underpants.
Yes. Yes.
And they say underpants tell a story, and they bloody well do. I don't know if you can get a close fix on the Grimmett gusset. But bloody hell, you can see he put what I describe as a fair bit of work on the on the hole, didn't he? Bloody, so I got those, I think that was $6,849 I snared those for.
Yes.
What did you get?
Well, look, I got lot 147, and this set me back the best part of $14,000. But I was so pleased to get it because it's a pencil.
Yeah.
It's a Clary Grimmett pencil, and I don't know whether the cameras are sophisticated enough to pick up this little signature here, simply written Clary.
Clary.
On it. So I was pretty convinced it was
one of Clary's. Oh, it's Clary. Oh, yeah.
And it's got obviously teeth marks in it as well, which I'm getting a forensic dentist to have a look at during the week, hoping to match with the dental record.
They say you can always tell Clary from his smell. That's Clary.
What I was told in the notes that accompanied this lot that this was the pencil that scored the Dons 302 at the SCG against, I think it was New South Wales v Queensland at the time. So it's a pencil with history.
Yeah, yeah. We might give these away at the end of the night. I'd like everyone to go home with a little bit of clarity.
Yeah.
So we'll cut this up. Obviously, I'll keep the gusset and we'll give away the rest.
Very generous offer, Roy. And now, our customers, can you welcome to the Channel 9 show a man who is one of the few magicians left in Australian media. Years ago, there were heaps of them. Now, who's the one left? Niners, can you start ticking like a 60 minutes clock as you join the Richard Carleton Experience, laying down that heavy beat of welcome for Richard Carleton?
Is there blood on your hands? Was his classic probe. Now, with 60 minutes, he struts the globe. He'll learn his craft at the ABC. And cashed the check on commercial TV. Richard Carleton dressed in black. Big Dick Carleton can't resist a crack. He's got the snare, he's got the face. Mention Mogoto, he can still smell the jazz. Here's R.C. Richard Carleton.
Mr. Slaven?
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. Nelson?
Yes.
I'd like to thank you both very much indeed for coming here to the studios tonight.
Yes, yes.
Mr. Packer asked me that extend to you.
Was that senior or junior?
Both, Mr. Packers. Yes. Extend to you appreciation for you giving up the Dapto dogs tonight.
Yep. Yes.
And coming here on this special occasion.
Yes.
And I wanted to ask you, yes, in the circumstances, yes, that Miss McFeast finds herself presently,
yes,
do either of you feel at all embarrassed by the blood on your hands?
Oh, we do, Richard, we do. And I'm glad you've asked that question because, you know, your questions haven't improved over the years, have they? You know, you can sit there with that idiotic grin on your face.
Give me five.
Now, speaking of that magic bit of television, we've actually got that queued up. Let's have a look at it now.
Now to Brisbane and Mr. Bob Hawke. Mr. Hawke, could I ask you whether you feel a little embarrassed tonight at the blood that's on your hands?
You're not improving, are you? I thought you might have been here. No. It's a ridiculous question. You know it's ridiculous. I have no blood on my hands. I was not involved in the discussions that Bill Hayden's fellow leaders had with him. I hope the standard of your questioning improves. When I went into that executive this morning, I had no knowledge whatsoever that he was making his decision. Now, Mr. Carleton, you can sit there with your silly, quizzical face. You've got a reputation right around this country. Yeah, it's looking better still. You've got a reputation for your impertinence, your refusal to accept people at their face value, to try and ridicule the integrity of people. Now, I don't mind my integrity being on the line against yours.
Yes. It, of course, went on in that vein for some hours. How do you get on with Bob these days?
I don't call him.
No.
He doesn't call me.
No. How did you get on with him in his period of prime ministership? You know, obviously, that was a starting step towards him becoming Prime Minister, and how did the next, say, 10 years go?
Not too good.
No, no. And of the current lot of politicians, are there any that you actually like talking to?
No.
No.
Is the short answer.
No. And with the development of politics, say, through then, you've maintained probably a fairly consistent line in your approach to interviewing politicians?
Probably, yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you ever overplayed your hand with them? Have you ever done something where you thought...
Not with politicians, no.
You can't?
No, never. But I probably have in other areas, yes.
Yes. And have you ever found yourself in a circumstance with a report for 60 Minutes where you thought, oh, I've gone a bit far here, or...?
Yes, after the event.
Right, right. And where and what,
you know? There was an occasion over in Perth with a dole bludger. And he'd been on the dole, we thought, well, factually, longer than anyone else. And I had him up against a wall and I said to him, you're not much of an excuse for a human being, are you? And he wasn't, but he didn't need me to tell him.
No.
And that's probably where I went too far.
Right.
He must have been a pretty soft target, wasn't he, Richard? I mean, is that the stick, choosing soft targets? Because
no,
a lot of politicians like to punch you in the head. Has it ever struck you that you know, you've got the sort of head that people want to punch in? I mean, we find it obviously an endearing quality, but a lot wouldn't. You know, can you appreciate that? Do you ever think, look in the mirror and think, bloody hell, why do so many people want to punch this head in?
I don't care.
No, well, that shows. Why don't you care?
Oh, you're going to ask my mother, I suppose. I just don't.
You've never cared?
Not really, no. No. No, I mean, I like to think that I approach it responsibly and that sort of thing, but I don't really see why I should shut up.
There was a 60 Minutes sort of maximal credo some time ago to divide the nation, multiply the ratings.
Yes.
Do you believe that? Is that a...
Well, there's no doubting, not in 60 Minutes, but in the ABC and everywhere else, that you have good controversy, you have people fighting, and the numbers go up.
Yeah.
So you don't mind that sort of combative sort of circumstance?
I made my living out of it.
Yes.
I mean, in this very room.
Yeah. Mm. Do you have to engineer that sometimes, though? You know, you get a number of people
who
largely...
Well, you don't ask two bunnies to come in and to, you know, run around the place.
Yes. No, but what I mean was sometimes they go a bit quiet, don't they? The stoolies who you've got in there, for want of a better expression. You've got to cheer them up with a prod a bit, don't you?
You mean with when you have an audience?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, of course.
Yes.
Yes.
And what are some of the techniques there?
Well, you look for the person that's got a view to express and you get them to express it and... then get someone else to knock them down.
Right.
Of the incidents in the world this week, and there's been a, you know, a few, which ones do you think, well, which one would you like to cover for 60 Minutes, of the big ones that have hit the front pages?
Well, I mean, India is the thing that matters to the world,
mm-hmm.
but Indonesia is what matters to us.
Mm.
You try getting a visa for either of the places.
Yes, yes.
And if you were going in there on a sort of parachute mission, how would you start and who would you talk to of the people that you can see from Australia? You may find some people up in the hills who have a different idea, but of the big figures, who would you like to get to talk to?
In Indonesia?
Say, starting off.
Waranto, surely.
Yes, of course. Yes.
I mean, he's the kingmaker. He's you know, painted as the kingmaker and ask him.
Yes.
Yes. Keep it in mind, son.
Now, with 60 Minutes, the one story that I think has caused some comment is, well, amongst many, of course, is the James Scott incident in the Himalayas.
The Iceman.
Now, the story ran, for those who may have forgotten, was the lad lived in the in a cave in the Himalayas on a couple of Mars bars.
Cadbury's, that's right. Cadbury's made in India, not made in Tasmania.
Right.
With a hell of a lot more sugar, one imagines, than...
I believe so.
Yes.
I believe so.
So he lived, what, for 43 days or something?
Something like that.
Yes. Yeah. Now, you were highly suspicious, I think it's fair to say, of this achievement.
No, I wasn't. I wasn't. What happened was, interviewing the bloke, and he gave inconsistent... I'm getting him to tell his story. I'm leading him down the path. What happened next? What happened then? What happened then?
Mm-hmm.
And he gave an inconsistent answer to two similar questions. And when he gave the second answer, he knew, by the way, he rose up like that, that he had made a mistake.
Right.
Because he was trying, on Harry Miller's instructions, to protect the possibility that he could get an endorsement for Cadbury's. And so he held that back. Yeah. And I, from that moment on, not before, from that moment on, when he'd been shown, to my eyes anyway, to be inconsistent, I was suspicious. Yes.
Right. And you don't have any idea of what might have happened up there for 43 days?
I don't care.
No. Well, maybe he was only up there for half an hour.
There's not a story there.
And it was really cold, he had the chockies and... managed to be found, really luckily, within the half hour. Is that more likely?
Look, I knew his story because the previous week I'd met the guy that he was hiking with.
Right.
And I'd done an interview with that guy that had played on the previous week's programme. Right. He'd told me the whole story. So it was for James to tell his story.
Right.
But I had there was no inquisitorial role on my part.
No.
I just led him down the line.
And did his story equate with the other chaps?
Up to the chocolate, yeah.
So, there might have been a damn sight more than the chocolate, one imagines, possibly.
Oh, no. I don't think so. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
Well, why haven't Cadbury's got him and said, you know, here he is?
I think Harry put too big a price on it. Oh, I don't know that, but I think that.
Yeah. Look, you're a member of the Australian Skeptics.
Yes, he's good.
That's fine. You don't like gullibility, do you? Do you like people? Because you hate the gullibility of people, don't you? I mean, Geraldine Doog says of you that you had enormous optimism which changed to awesome cynicism very, very quickly. Fred Hollow says of you that you don't believe in anything. Do you like people or not? You don't, because they're suckers, aren't they? And you dabble in magic so you can exploit and enjoy exploiting the stupidity of people. Do you think people are stupid? Is that fair enough?
Where's the question mark?
It's not rhetorical. I'm asking the question. Do you think people are stupid?
No, of course not. No, with Fred, I went to Eritrea with Fred.
Yeah. And told him he was being stupid.
I did not. It was plain as the nose on your face that the Eritreans then were getting arms from Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
And there was a price attached to it.
Yeah.
There was a price attached to it. The Eritreans were to influence their country's vote when they became a country against Israel.
Yes.
I mean that was the politics. I mean anyone that is deeply interested in that knows that.
Yeah.
Fred would not accept for one moment that the Eritreans had one Kalashnikov from anywhere other than the taxi drivers in New York and Washington who were sending money over for the good cause. Now, I support the Eritreans. They have a wonderful cause. They're a wonderful people. But I thought Fred was a bit silly to
but
imagine...
Fred was
that
just helping out people who were blind.
Exactly. A wonderful man. A wonderful man.
Yeah.
He'll leave a lot... When he died, the number of happy people he left behind will be millions more than the number I will. And I accept that and acknowledge that. He was a great man, a great Australian.
Right.
But it didn't stop me arguing with him when he was plain wrong.
Right.
Now, you're a great hobby magic magician. I think you bent a spoon for Sharon Stone at one stage. Now,
I dropped a hanky for Margaret Thatcher once too.
Yes, but when you picked it up, there was something else in it.
No, let me tell you the story. It's one of these silly little things. It's silly. Anyone could do it. They're tuppence at a magic shop. I pushed this red hanky in here and then leant over and said to her, blow. And she bent from the waist and then she went back and she said, why should I? Yeah. I said, oh, well, because if you blow, it will disappear. Yeah. And she said, oh, I expect it to disappear. I'd be much more impressed if you could turn it blue.
Could you do that? Could you? That'd be some bloody
That'd
trick,
be a...
wouldn't it? To turn the bloody thing blue.
It'd be
wouldn't
some
you? Don't you wish you could have been able to bloody do that? That would have made her look stupid.
I think the blue hanky trick is a $5 trick at any magic shop. But what I wanted to develop was the connection between magic as a form of entertainment and current affairs as a form of entertainment. And I think there is a bit of a link here. I think you perpetrated the so-called Carlos hoax some time ago. And, you know, I know I was speaking with you before concerning a fraud, which I, concerning the, with the scacing positioning of, you know, a film on a rival network concerning the filming of Barcelona and pretending it was where Scace lived.
Yeah, well, that was just fraud. I mean, there was no magic about that.
No, but my point is more, is that have you adapted ideas out of the, you know, the world of presenting magic to the world of presenting current affairs?
No, but I will admit that in, you know, occasional difficult circumstances, if you've got a bit of effrontery and you go up to a soldier and, you know, say you drop this hanky, mate, look here now, blow, can I go through the roadblock? Mm-hmm. You've got a better chance than if you haven't got a hanky.
Right.
And, you know, he's got a kangaroo badge on his lapel and that sort of thing. So it's not really magic. But look, please, I mean, what I do is, you know, for around the dinner table, I'm never going to compete. And I don't want to present myself as competing with the pros.
No, I accept that. It was more the ideas behind, you know, some of these things, you know, directing the gaze in that direction while you're fiddled about here before the crowd turns back, that sort of thing. I think that's a very standard...
There are too many cameras,
right? Oh, yeah, oh, well. No. In current affairs.
Yeah, there are a lot of cameras in current affairs.
Yeah, I know. But as a standard, pulling the head, so-called, is a standard aspect of magic. Now, pulling the head, I think it could be... You could claim there was a standard aspect of current affairs as well.
I don't know pulling the head in magic, mate, I'm saying.
Oh, well, you just divert the gaze of someone.
Oh,
while
I
you
see.
Are yeah. able to... Yeah, while you're yeah. able to complete the trick.
Yeah, it's a...
A long bow?
A long bow.
Quite
mates long, mates of yours say that you do magic around the dining room table when people come around for dinner because you don't like talking to them.
Yeah, I know that's been said. That's right.
Is that the case?
Well, amongst the half dozen pro magicians I know around the world, most of them are, you know, sort of slightly, you know, not right. It tends to be.
When are we going to get that story on 60 Minutes? All magicians are lunatics.
And you've got to be very careful with that sort of thing, that you you don't use it as a, you know, excuse for not talking to people. You've got conversation, haven't you?
Yeah. Well, we've got conversation tonight, but only because you didn't want to do a magic trick.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's because I'm portraying myself as a magician.
Oh, okay.
I'm not.
No, but we're not expecting Penn and Teller here.
Oh.
We're expecting
Mr. Tully.
But you saw Penn and Teller on the Carlos show.
You did. Yes, that's right.
They're a great duet.
Yes. Now, Richard, obviously, you more than most would realise that we do have commitments here at the Channel 9 show and Australia. Can you keep that clock ticking as a way of thanking Richard Carlton?
Way back when, and this year it's gonna be a winner again. But I want you to know, after all these years,
we're still having fun. Still the one.
Japanese, Italian, singing water. The drink that's looking for a fight.
Princess Di, Kurt Cobain, Michael Hutchence, Frank Sinatra. In this 60 Minutes exclusive, we track down the celebrity killer.
Yeah, I did him. I hated him.
I'm Richard Pelt.
I'm Liz Hayes.
I'm Roy Smith.
And I'm H.G. Nelson. All these stories and more tomorrow night on 60 Minutes. Yes, the Australian automotive industry, or the automotive world in Australia, was rocked this week by the news that Peter Brock is a bit bored of sitting around the house and he's going to get back out and do what he does best, and that's drive cars bloody quick. And Roy, what's Brocky up to? What's he got on the cards? What's the agenda?
Yeah, look, I don't know if the details have been fleshed out yet. I don't know. My understanding is it's a sort of round Australia rally.
Yeah.
But I don't know if it's just Brocky by himself. I'd like to think it was. And I think it's Brocky driving from Melbourne, taking in every capital city, including Townsville, not that it's a capital city, but I think he goes that far north, then to Ayers Rock, then up to Darwin, via Broome, to Perth, Esperance, Adelaide, back to Melbourne. And I think it's a terrific opportunity for a lot of people who haven't seen Brocky at work, in particular kiddies.
Yes, yes.
To get out there and have a look at Brocky.
Right.
Look, I don't know many other details apart from that. My understanding is he's got to go to each GPO in those places and post a letter and sign a register and then head off again. And I assume once he gets to Melbourne, they'll have clocked it. You know, it might be 47 days, 56 hours, 22 minutes, 14 seconds. Then he goes off again to try and beat that. I think that's the idea.
Having collected the mail that he posted to himself,
that's
on the way
exactly
around.
That's exactly right. Well, that could work.
Yeah. Now, look. I'm wondering what school kiddies would get out of this. I mean, Brocky moves at a bloody, you know,
he'd be up over
a tonne and a half. Say if he was sponsored by, say, the Commodore people, the Holden people,
he might
get in one of those new Berliners or something like that, HSV style vehicle.
Oh, yes.
And Brocky, you know, if I was a kiddie standing out the front, might go back like that. I don't know whether that'd be 150 kilometres an hour, my hand movement there, but he'd be getting up.
He'd be getting up there. Yeah.
And so, what would kiddies get out of that?
Yeah, well, they wouldn't get much out of that, obviously, but if schools, teachers could organise them to be around the GPOs.
True.
You know what
or
I mean?
They could
you'd
do
see
projects.
Rocky cruising, he'd change gears and braking, you'd see all that.
And
you'd see how he opens a door, although the door might be fused, he might have to climb out the window. Well, that's still Brocky.
Yeah.
He'd climb out the window, running up the steps, the kiddies would be in there, he might sign a few autographs on his way. Excuse me, Mr. Brock, could I? Yeah, sorry. Off he goes. Signs the register, posts the mail, back into the car. I've seen all that.
And they would have done a project on Brocky.
Where he's going, what he's doing. Yes.
And products that come from those areas.
Yes.
Now, when the organisers, I don't know who'd be organising this rally, but Peter probably hadn't got time to do it all himself.
Yeah.
You know, what arrangements with the local police would he need to make?
Yes.
Would it be sort of set the lights for green as I come through?
Yes.
You know, VIP
or a police escort when he gets within, say, 100 kilometres of the GPO to which he was intending to go.
Yes.
They could probably go and form a convoy.
Yes.
They're more spectacular for the kiddies.
Yeah.
And then they'd see kiddies, then they'd see police people drive, how they drive, because they're really good drivers. Maybe Brocky in front with them trying to catch up to him.
With the sirens going.
Yeah, well, they'd give Brocky a siren to put on. He'd be an honorary policeman.
Yeah, right.
Or police person. There'd be a sort of ceremony just on the outskirts of town. Do you swear to uphold it?
Yes, yes,
sir. He'd put a uniform on. It'd be fabulous.
Yes, well, it would be good. Now, the idea of him going round again to beat his time, I mean, is it a best of 10 run? Or something like that? Best of 10? I mean,
I'd like you to see him keep going until kiddies don't turn up anymore.
Yes. Roy, the other big news that broke this week, and I was shocked by this, was that apparently the man who did much to popularise the underwater world and, obviously film it in the early days, Jacques Cousteau, faked many of his early film work. This story is apparently just rocking Europe at the moment. It has been, a BBC expose with featuring Richard Carleton, I understand. Roy, you've had a look at a lot of early Cousteau footage. Have you seen anything in that footage that makes you think the scenes were cutted up?
Yeah, look, I think, you know, if you get, say, two flathead together or two brim, anything like that, you put them together, I can't tell the difference between them. You know, they look the same to me. You know, you can put them behind your pen. Richard Carleton, magic style and pull it back out. And he might have swapped them, but I'm bugger if I can tell. And I think Jacques Cousteau twigged to this pretty early on.
Yes.
So he realised if you put a fish in a toaster or something like that, stupid, and it dies, well, you just replace it with another one. You know what I mean? Coming out the other end. And so it looks as if he's trained a fish to go through a toaster. You know what I mean? And I think that's fair, because film is all about illusion.
Yes.
You know, all about illusion. Mel Gibson, when he was doing that Braveheart, was all done with mirrors.
Yeah.
There were only two, cast of two. Yeah. There was bloody mirrors everywhere. That was the expensive bit.
Yeah.
Laurence Olivier, you know, if he was upset and he had to cry, would pull nose hairs out. Yeah. And it would come the tears. Yeah, it's illusion.
Yeah.
Well, Jacques was no different.
Yeah.
Except he could kill his bloody cast if he wanted to. And nobody cared.
Well, in that memorable sequence where he gets a shark to eat a kerosene tin, you know, with a brick inside it, and proved to the world that sharks are
sharks eat kerosene.
And revolutionised people's, you know, ideas about sharks. Yeah. Well, he starved the shark for about 6 months.
6 months.
Before he let it loose.
Oh, he's a cruel bugger.
Yeah.
But he got great films out of it.
Yeah.
You know, I've experimented with... Look, I discovered if you do get, say, like a flounder...
Yeah.
...or a flathead...
Yeah.
And you want to make a bit of a, you want to give it a personality.
Yes.
I found if you rip the fins off the left-hand side, just tear them off.
Wingy.
Yeah, wingy.
Yeah.
Then they'll swim to the left. I found if you nick their mouths just with a knife, they grin. So you can... And if you get a needle and just dock it in the eye, in the right eye, like that, not too far, because you don't want vitreous humour and that sort of stuff going on the lens, dock like that, you get a real personality if they wink. As they go around. Oh, they're great fun.
Yeah.
Because you can just, you can bloody shove sticks up their date. And you can get them doing all sorts of things. See, you can get them coming in like this, you know. I don't know if you can see that. You know, you might have... Say they're two dead fish.
Yeah.
Just with sticks up them.
Yeah.
Well, you make sure you don't see, you know, sticks. There's stick.
Yeah.
Here. And you can have them going... Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You can do incredible things with dead bloody fish.
Yeah.
That's what sharks did.
Yeah.
Do you think the people of the world should feel cheated?
No, why?
Oh, yeah,
he told a story.
Yeah.
You know, fish are lovely, beautiful, friendly.
Sometimes they go a bit funny.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, my very good friends, the Channel 9 show has a policy of showcasing the best the world of entertainment has to offer, and tonight we continue to cash that check. Australia, can you give a rowdy Channel 9 show welcome to Rene Geyer, who is heading in the right direction?
As a small girl, I've always been alone, trying so hard to find someone that I could call my own. People that I looked at, they were always twos and threes, always on the outside, nobody wanted me. From the rest, you never tried to cheat on me like so many did before. You made me feel important, special in your eyes. Knowing that you care for me makes me want to come alive. Wanna know
your love and affection.
Is it gonna be
a brand new star?
It's the way to your heart. Day to day,
felt that she might hear changes all around me. Gonna wipe away my tears. No more pain and heartache. No more sleepless nights. Cause I know that I won't stay for the rest of my life.
Leonardo's liquid dog butter. Available now.
Innovations.
Hi, and welcome to Innovations. My guest in the studio this week is Dr. Bike Frenson from the University of Seattle State. Doctor, it's a pleasure to meet you.
Hi, Ian. Call me Bike.
Bike. Okay, Bike. Now, what have you got to show us today?
Okay, Ian, the penis. How many times have you heard men and women around the world complaining about the size of the penis?
Well,
it's okay, Ian. No need to be embarrassed about it. It's not a problem anymore. Because you can have a penis of any desired length, and it's quite a pleasant experience.
I see.
Okay, believe me, look. Simply by attaching the Bike Frenson lengthener spring to the penis and the sock, the gentle tension gives you inches within weeks. It's simply a matter of making it the attachment part of your daily dressing procedure. And it's a fun thing to do.
I'll bet. And you can attach the Bike Frenson lengthener spring to any sock?
Any sock, any penis, guarantee it.
That is fantastic.
Only problem is knowing when long enough is long enough.
I'll bet. Now, anyone out there who'd like to get a hold of the Bike Frenson lengthener spring can do so by calling the number on the screen and have your credit card handy. Well, Doctor, it's been a great pleasure.
Pleasure's all mine, Ian.
And I'll be back again next week with more innovations.
Channel 9 show, please welcome Wendy.
Just an FM wave away.
Yeah, you handled the stairs beautifully.
I had three anxiety dreams that I fell down those stairs like a sack of spuds at the beginning of the show, and I made it, and I'm very pleased to be here.
Now, what have you also been dreaming about? And at what stage in the dream, should I say, does the anxiety set in? Does the anxiety set in knowing you're going to do it, or is when you feel like the sack of spuds? Because I feel as though that would be anxious-making if I was dreaming that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, let's talk football, then. You got off badly with the AFL because, as a kid, you were forced to sit in the car while half the rest of the family went and watched the Geelong Cats go
around. Well, my father played football, would you believe, till the age of 40.
What an idiot.
Yeah, I know. He actually had his glasses taped to his head with gaffer. And he used to play footy. He used to run around the paddock.
Yeah.
And the four of us would be watching Dad yelling out, you know, come home, that sort of thing.
Did you watch it from the car?
Yeah, well, you know, and we used to, you know, those country footy matches where everyone pulls the cars in.
Hong Kong.
Yeah, and you have your sandwiches and so forth, and then you get out at halftime, you collect bottles.
And
get the returns on those. But I spent a good part of my childhood sitting in the car watching Dad play footy.
Did you give him a honk whenever he got the ball?
Yeah, well, the thing was, I remember there was one particular incident where my brothers and sisters, we were standing there and Dad was playing full back, and the ball, this is at 40, hit him on the... He had a bit of a tum by this stage. Yeah. Hit him on the stomach and some guy yelled out, rubber guts! And we all fronted this guy and, you know, we stepped in defence.
Actually,
squirrel grip out in the car park. Yeah. It was just ugly, you know. But, we did that.
Now, of course, this would be a bit of a setback for an appreciation of the AFL, you know, being forced to watch it. But I understand you've become... Since, you know, obviously supporting the Geelong Cats briefly, you become a bit of a rugby league convert.
I must be one of the few people in Australia who's gone the other way, I think.
Yes. Yeah.
Because I think the thing about your game of rugby league is you don't get the squirrel grip, you know, around the edge of the pack, sneaky, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
You just go out and rip the guy's head off in full view.
Yes.
And this is, you know, it's got to be one of the last gladiatorial contests. You just neck the guy, you know, you just beat him to a pulp
And it's considered good play.
It's an honest game.
Yeah.
Do you
find
that exciting when you see blokes really hammering?
You bet I do. Something real nice about it. I can't exactly explain what it is, but it's, you know.
But you have taken on the hardest club to support, haven't you?
Oh, well, I have indeed.
We're talking about the Manly Sea Eagles. And we're talking about the burden of not only the history of... all that, you know, the current problems with the team not going so well.
Greatly misunderstood team.
Yeah. By who?
You couldn't get a nicer... You go down the Manly Leagues Club... I'm sorry, you go down the Manly Leagues Club on a Friday night after you've had a big game.
Beautiful spot.
Cliffy's down there.
It's great.
David Gillespie, you know, cement in his day.
Yes.
There's a big drinking school on. You couldn't wish to meet a nicer bunch of gents.
That's right. Yeah. Well, that's rugby league.
It is rugby league.
It's all lovely. Look, I don't want to change the subject, but I am.
Okay.
Because we can talk about the Manly Club forever and get nowhere because there's nowhere to go with it. But you, I read, knocked back an offer to appear on the Fox cable network's Beauty and the Beast. I find that very hard to believe,
Wendy.
Why did you knock that back? A golden opportunity.
Stan Zemanek.
Yes.
Would be the number one reason. I don't think you have to go any further.
What did you say to them? How did the offer come?
I did the wrong... I don't know whether... This was pretty rude. But I rang them and I said, basically, he's the kind of guy I'd chew my own arm off to get away. You know how sometimes you have that bad experience where you sit next to the nutter on the bus with the, with the travel bag and the beanie? Why would you front up every week to do it in a studio?
Yeah. You pointed this out to him, did you?
Yeah, I did, actually. I haven't been offered anything else since, you know, but... No, I think there's enough sort of right-wing peanuts running around the place without actually sort of going and sitting next to one.
Do you miss doing stand-up?
Yeah, I do sometimes. I actually recently went to see Victoria Wood come perform in Sydney, and I was sitting in the audience and I suddenly thought, crikey, I can do this.
Yeah.
I did do this. I think probably when the radio days are over, I might get back up there.
Is it hard getting up and being funny every bloody morning of the week at an ungodly bloody hour? Honestly, I don't know how you do it.
Well, you sort of get paid, you know, like that's the gig, you know. So, I love it. It's a great job. It really is. I mean, you've got a great job. What other job do you get where you actually purposely, you get paid to get, just have a cat every day? Yeah.
Mm. That's true.
That's not bad, is it?
No, it's good.
Well, and you don't, we do have a cat every day. Mm. So
The only other better job I can think of is playing rugby league.
Yeah.
Where you get your head knocked off enormously. Have you met Bozo Fulton?
No, I haven't.
Is he a goose?
I haven't met him, but I actually have seen him driving in the car. I saw him sort of speed through Collaroy at a great, you know, clip. Yeah. And
this was when the side was losing, I
see. Right. And my husband said, "There's Bozo," as he sort of into the distance.
But, was he speeding?
No, seatbelt on. They're gents, you know. Yeah. I think the thing is, and I think my husband's in the audience now, and he would tell you, his mother, Shirley, would tell you, Shirley is 78 and she's big on Manny Warringah, but they are a greatly misunderstood team.
Right. Mm.
Well, I think you've turned me right around.
Yeah, I'm on board. Yeah.
Who do you barrack for? Do you have a team?
I support in the rugby league the Parramatta Eels.
You do?
Yes, I do. I support the Parramatta Eels. I'll never forget that night when they won all those years ago and Jack Gibson got up and said, "Ding dong, the witch is dead."
It was a terrific night.
Anything else about it?
My conversion to rugby league came. My husband Brendan. He took me to the SFS, and we were sitting there, and Jack Elsgood was playing on the wing, and I'm like, "Oh, rugby league, it's really boring." And Jack was, you know, he's
a
not a bad.
He's a hunk.
Hunk, not too fine a point on it. Yeah. And someone was sort of bearing down on him at a great kind of rate of knots. And unbidden, unknown, I jumped up and yelled out, "Not the face!" You know. I was a convert after that, basically.
Right, so it's become a cathartic thing for you. You really do relate very closely
I even will listen to Wilco do the call. Yeah. Whether you're in for a big night or not.
Yeah.
You see, if your husband goes to the footy, and you stay home and you listen to the call, you know whether to get the lingerie out in the club colours or not.
Yes.
So he can take you through the big hits play by play.
Do you like the footy show? Would you go on the footy show?
I think the footy show is one of the funniest shows. I don't know whether you saw this, they had a contest on recently where they have a contest where they have a player and they have the player's great fan. Mm.
Yes.
And they say who Beat knows the most about the player. And I saw Ryan Girdler, he plays for Penrith, doesn't he? Yeah. He was asked what colour are your eyes, and he got it wrong. Now, that is classic comedy. You just can't... You cannot write that stuff.
No.
Especially
from rugby league players. Right up there with your Marx brothers WC Fields.
It's classic stuff.
Look, do you think Peter Costello's been taking grinning lessons?
Oh, Peter...
He turned the smirk right up to an idiotic grin at some stage this week.
Do you know what I reckon? Yeah. I reckon that they... You know how they shoot him from the waist up?
Yeah.
I reckon that probably when he's announcing cuts to hospitals and things, there might be a bit of action in the trouser department.
They should shoot him from the waist down.
I always love when last year you might remember they tried to humanise, you know, they always try to humanise the treasurer, so you see him sort of walking through country glades in open neck shirts. Yeah. They had him on Burke's back yard last. Did you see his garden? Did anyone here see his garden on Burke's back? There was not a living thing. Yeah. It was like it had been nuked, you know.
Do you think he's got Richard Carlton's got a head that anyone like would love to have a punch.
Yeah.
Do you think Peter Costello has the same sort of punchability factor that...
Definitely. He's got to be one of those kids at school, "Wipe that smirk off your face, Costello." You know, he's going to be one of those. But I think really, a surplus anyway is not sexy.
No.
See, for my money, Paul Keating managed to make a deficit really kind of sexy. In a sadomasochistic kind of way.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know. It's hurting you, but you're loving it.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And a surplus.
So Keating was more a sort of Jack Ellsgood sort of treasurer. Well, what's Costello? I mean.
Oh, Costello, what sort of treasurer is that? I mean, you know, the Treasury broadcast, of course. I mean, it's the sort of thing you threaten small children with, isn't it? It's boring, you know. I think what they should do is busk it a bit, jazz it up.
Yeah.
And I think what they could do is say when he's announcing the ABC budget, for instance, he could get that black cloth cap and he could put it on his head and he could say, "You will be taken from this place and hung by the neck until you are dead." You know,
very like slowly.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, he could kind of, he could have a barrel.
When he
announces a tax rebate or something, they could dip in, and the lucky family who's going to get it, they could pull it out. Announce it on the air. There's a million ways to jazz the thing up, but it's pretty boring.
Yeah, it is.
And he's just
Do you think he's modelled himself on Keating? Can you see that?
Similarities? I think maybe the physicality, but he hasn't got the. He hasn't got the language, the metaphor, the simile, the glamour, the...
The hammer.
He hasn't got the suit. He hasn't got a lot of things.
Yeah. So he's still got a fair way to go.
No, I would say so.
Look, Wendy...
But Reefy's made a complete goose of himself. So, you know, maybe he's on the inside running at the moment.
Look, we could talk politics all night and probably will. Wendy, working at Today FM, you'd appreciate the problem of commitments here at the Channel 9 show. Niners, can you smash all the big hits as a way of thanking Wendy Hammer?
Thank you.
Say at the start of every day, just a nip and wave away. It's the Wendy Hammer way. Wendy Hammer is fun, things you would today.
For the first time on television,
universities from every state and territory.
Sale of the Century State of Origin University Challenge, the ultimate test of minds for Australia's finest students.
We're up there with these guys.
Sales University Challenge starts 7 o'clock Monday.
Hello, it's me, City, back with even better 5-ring gold medal deals on wheels. Look, cars, 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 a whole Olympic village full of cars, both used and new. As my missus says, if you're selling cars at those prices, don't come home.
Don't come home, City.
See? You see me and twist my arm for an Olympic Games winning gold medal deal. As my very good mate Kevin Cosper says, with the Olympic Games, everybody's a winner!
Big beasts. I've got huge beasts. Plump, firm, hot, supple. Oh, baby, foamy and divine. For foam with bone, call 00226699.
A life-saving limb for a lame pony.
There you go, Ruby. New shoes.
The sorry tale of an endangered panda. The Outback's mobile vet. Plus a happy fate for a sad seal. Animal Hospital, 7:30 Thursday on 9.
And now it's time for Come On In, Ray!
It's only one game to play at the business end of the day.
It's time for Come On In, Ray! Yes, Come On In, Ray!
Yes, once again it's time to play Come On In, Ray, where you get a chance to win fabulous prizes simply by wondering whether Ray is behind or door A or door Y. And who's the lucky contestant this evening, Roy?
Hey, see, we've got Joy joining us. Come on in, Joy. How are you?
Yes, come on in, Joy.
Good. Thanks for coming. Joy, you've... I'll get you to face the camera if that's all right.
There you go.
You've come down from Queensland.
I have, yes.
Just to see the show?
Yes.
What part of Queensland?
Surfer's Paradise.
Surfer's Paradise. How are things going at Surfer's
terrific.
Paradise?
Terrific. Absolutely.
You like
terrific.
It up there?
Love it.
You've always lived there?
No.
When did you move there?
14 years ago.
You don't regret a moment of
not
it?
Not a moment.
Isn't that tremendous?
It is. Yes, you've had a lot of rain up there recently.
Yes, but we needed it.
Did you? Yes, I noticed they had to call the races off up there today. Yes, it was a very, very sad moment.
I've been down here for a fortnight.
Oh, have you enjoying the rain down
here? So you haven't come down just for the show at all. That was a lie. What about Schoolies Week? Do you like Schoolies Week?
And that was the second reason.
Oh, the second reason.
Yes.
Okay, well, listen.
Schoolies Week, no.
Do you like Schoolies Week?
We love Schoolies
Week. We love Schoolies Week.
The kiddies.
For the kiddies, that's right. Now, are you prepared to take the challenge?
I am.
Okay, you've got to pick which door Ray might be behind. Can we have the knock, please? Ah, that must be Ray. Could you see where he is? These are the knobs.
Knock again. Can we hear Ray knocking again?
Thank you.
Oh, the knock's getting weaker.
Doesn't give you much of a clue.
That one.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Look at that.
Lizzie Hayes there, and I think Hugh Remington in the middle there.
Yeah. Well, now, congratulations, Joy. You're going to have 9 seconds at the Sutcliffe of Soup.
And, of course, you get the apron that's yours to keep, never mind how much soup stuff you get together. And, Roy, the implements, yes, if you
implements.
Don't mind.
You can use this, or if you wish to use your hands, that's fine. Yes, we've got bacon bones here, we've got pumpkins, we've got... For the dogs? No, for you. We've got the chicken.
To make your stock.
Everything's here. Are you ready? You've got 9 seconds. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Oh, well done.
Well done, yes.
You know, a few chickpeas to go with that.
Yeah, that's tremendous.
We've just got to boil it all up. Boil it all up.
And, of course, you get the Come On In, Ray game to have all the fun of playing Come On In, Ray at home with you and your family. It's a tremendous game. Hours of fun inside there.
And the photograph.
There we
go. There we are. I put that there. Yes, just to prove it. Now, you've got everything, Joy. Yes. Congratulations.
Thank you,
thank you for
thank
playing
you.
Come thank On you. In, Ray.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
So, well, look, sadly, that brings us to the end of another week on the Channel 9 show, Roy. But we do have an offer, a wonderful offer, a very generous offer. And firstly, can I preface my comments about the offer saying all the George Negus's have gone. At last, we've managed to get rid of George, that marvellous photo of George, which is now adorning many, many rooms across the nation. But what's on offer this week, Roy?
Actually, we have a marvellous shot of Brian Johns, the managing director of the ABC. It's called The Captain's Patch. $499 framed, $49.95 unframed. It's a beautiful shot. Look at that detail. It really is wonderful. And our switchboard operators are in situ now. Phone immediately with credit card details. That'll be a marvellous present.
It would. It would make a wonderful gift. Obviously, Christmas is just around the corner and Father's Day isn't that far away.
Oh, it's not that far away.
No, that's true.
A photograph of Brian would just look wonderful.
Roy, what will you be up to in the coming set of seven?
Look, I'm not too sure, actually. I know we have got a couple of tickets to see Catchphrase.
Yes.
To be in the audience of Catchphrase.
Well, that would be good.
So I'm going to go along and have a look at that just to see how they put it together. Because it confused me for a long while, that show. I didn't get it.
No.
But now I've sort of sorted it out. You've got to marry the clues in the pictures to the words or the phrases, and it's a tremendous show now. And Baby John's really hit the mark.
Yes. Do you think you'll be shouting out the answers to the dumb contestants?
Yeah, no bull, for example.
Right, right.
Yeah, things like
or
that.
Or pull the pin.
Pull the pin.
Yeah.
Now, attach bayonets.
Well, look, I've got a very big week.
India's got the bomb.
The FA Cup tonight, of course, and tomorrow I've got, Carlton and West Coast at Subiaco Oval, and then, of course, I'll be back on the Eastern Seaboard for Writers' Week.
Oh.
I love Writers' Week.
It's lovely, isn't it?
Yeah, just hearing people yabber about things they know bugger all about after they've written books about it.
Are you going to take the David Williamson session?
I'd love to. Yeah. That would be a popular session, but if I can get a ticket, or maybe cash in my Baby John Burgess catchphrase ticket for that,
okay.
I think I might be able to get...
Swap someone.
Swap someone. And this week, the Channel 9 show leaves you with a final tip of the hat in the direction of Francis Albert Sinatra. Here this evening, Tom Burlinson is supported on keyboard by Michael Harrison and their rendition of One for My Baby. See you next week, Niners.
Bye.
Thank you.
It's quarter to three. There's no one in the place except you and me. So set 'em up, Joe. I got a little story I think you should know. We're drinking, my friend, to the end of a brief episode. Make it one for my baby and one more for the road. I got the routine, put another nickel in the machine. Feeling so bad, can't you make the music easy and sad? I could tell you a lot, but you've gotta be true to your code. Just make it one for my baby and one more for the road. You'd never know it, but buddy, I'm a kind of poet, and I've got a lot of things I'd like to say. And when I'm gloomy, won't you listen to me till it's talked away? Well, that's how it goes. And Joe, I know you're getting anxious to close. So thanks for the cheer. I hope you didn't mind my bending your ear. But this torch that I found, it's gotta be drowned, or it soon might explode. So make it one for my baby and one more for the road. The long, very long, the long, it's so long.